Right. Just in time. Yeah, it's fine. Good morning. Right, so today we'll be focusing a lot on one of the most important ornithologists in South African history, Andrew Smith, but especially in light of the question yesterday about the weaverbird family, and also it's an appropriate time to just take a look forward. So we've been looking at Linnaeus and other people who've been describing weavers. For them it was all new, they didn't know what was coming. Today, in hindsight, we can say, well, these are the weavers. And so I've included slides from a talk on weavers, just to give you a bit of background about this is the group that we're talking about, just very briefly, and then I'll get to Andrew Smith. So, as I mentioned, it's a very colorful group, especially in the males. Often the females are a bit more dull and not so brightly colored, like the bishops here and in between. It doesn't always show all the females here, but mostly the males are very brightly colored. You see that yellow and red and black are predominant colors in the weaverbird family. And then some species have got very long tails, but other than that, they're all pretty much sparrow size. Some are slightly larger, but a fairly uniform group in that sense. Of course, they build these amazing nests, and the true weavers build these kind of nests where the grass is woven in and out, but then you've got the buffalo weavers, which have sticks that they just push in, and the sparrow weavers, some of these nests here that look very much like sparrow nests where they just push the grass in and it's not true weaving. Right, and then interestingly enough, there are some very rare species. I mentioned the Mauritius Fodi as being very rare, and it nearly went extinct. I don't know who attended the dodo talk yesterday in the afternoon. No one really, but there was a talk about the dodo, which comes from Mauritius. And of course, many other species did go extinct on Mauritius as well, but then a program was instituted to save birds like the Mauritius Fodi, the Mauritius Kestrel, and other species, and they fortunately are all doing well today. But on the other end of the scale, there's the red-billed quelea, which is considered the most numerous land bird on the planet. It's only found in Africa, but there are more quellas than any other land bird. There's some debate about one of the storm petrels, if that's more common or not than this. It's very hard to judge the numbers of these birds. But certainly this is a pest species. Governments in Africa try and kill it with explosions or chemicals because they attack small grain crops like wheat and millet. Right, so as I mentioned, the size doesn't vary too much. And the long-tailed widow has got a very long tail, up to half a meter long, so that's quite long. But the bird itself is not that large compared to starlings and crows and other passerine birds. Nests, the smallest one is the yellow bishop or other bishops, and then the largest is the sociable weaver, which we spoke a bit about, because Levaillant found the rosy-faced lovebird in the sociable weaver nest. And it's considered to be the largest nest built by birds, but again, it depends on how you define these things. Some people say, well, it's a communal nest, so you should rather look at what's the largest nest built by a single bird. And then occasionally you'll get exceptionally large nests. I mean, for instance, Varroa's eagle, there's a record of one nest that was 4 meters deep. And so you could say they don't normally have the largest nests, but occasionally they might have an exceptionally large nest. So, but on average, probably the sociable weaver's got the largest bird nest of any bird in the world. Right, these birds are not weavers. Just for example, the pin-tailed wider, sparrows, buntings, canaries, and waxbills. They have been considered part of the weaver family by early taxonomists and at different times. As I mentioned, they're very closely related, and so of course people have put them in, taken them out, moved them around, or just some of the groups. So there's been a lot of change, but at the moment they're not considered part of the weaver family. In recent decades, the sparrows and the sparrow weavers were considered to be one family, but that was by one author, and most people generally keep the arrangement that I prefer and will be talking about. So the weavers are found in sub-Saharan Africa, with some species in Southern Asia and the Indian Ocean islands, Madagascar and Seychelles, Comores, etc. The highest density of weavers is in the tropics and especially Eastern Africa. And just again to illustrate, you get the buffalo weavers, stick nests, sparrow weavers, and related sociable weaver and others with a dry grass nests, and then the true weavers that weave the nests with these different genera. And just very quickly, I'll go through all the different genera just to, with pictures, just to give you an idea of what the different weaver bird species are. So there are two buffalo weaver species. For all the maps, the yellow shows where all weavers are found, just as a backdrop, and the orange shows where these birds are found. So you can see fairly widely distributed, but not everywhere in Africa. Then the white-headed buffalo weaver, just a single species, found in Eastern Africa. The sparrow weavers, there are quite a few different species, four, and also found in the savanna areas. Rufous-tailed weaver, single species in this genus, found in Tanzania. The social weavers are not the same as the sociable weaver. These are found in East Africa, these two species, cooperative breeders. And then the sociable weaver in its own genus, found just in Namibia, South Africa, and Botswana, in the very arid areas. The scaly finches, there's these two species. Scaly down in southern parts, and the speckle-fronted in the northern and eastern parts. The thick-billed weaver, it's one species in this genus, but it has a lot of variation. I can see that it's paler down here and darker there, and there it's got those bars. So, and there are more subspecies than are shown here in different parts of Africa. Then the compact weaver, found along the Congo River and Western Africa. And then the true weavers, this is just a small selection of the about 60 species of Plosia species, and they cover this whole area. Not all the species, but there'll be at least one or a few species in every part shaded here. Then the Malimbis are forest weavers, very brightly colored, build nests with long tubes usually, found in the forests of Central and West Africa. The red-headed weaver, different subspecies, and these are now by some authors very recently considered to be separate species, and I'll be talking about that on Friday. Then the quellias, three species, including this red-billed quellia, this massive pest in Africa. The other two also eat grain, but they're not quite as bad as the red-billed quellia. Then the fodies on the Indian Ocean islands. Lots of interesting stories there that I'll be getting to on some of the days in the rest of this week. Bob-tailed weaver, again, restricted to the Congo River along there. And then the bishops and widows. You can see the widows have got long tails, and the bishops are small with very short tails. Right, this map shows the type localities of all the different weaver species, and the color indicates when they were collected. So red is the very early species that we talked about yesterday, and what you notice is that they're generally found along, or not too far from the coast, which makes sense. I mean, the early travelers and explorers would have come across new birds near the coast first. And so that's what one would expect. Then yellow is from the early 1800s. And we notice that, again, new species along the West African coast. Also, lots over here where an ornithologist, Rupel, was working and collecting lots of birds. But then there's a really large proportion here from South Africa. And that is largely due to Andrew Smith, and that's who we'll be talking about now. Then, of course, just to look ahead, you can see all the green and blue progressively gets into more remote areas and deep forest, but also still birds along the coast, but those are just with very range-restricted areas or just very uncommon, and so took longer to find. All right, so Andrew Smith was a Scottish surgeon who worked in the British Army, and of course he also became an explorer and zoologist. He's considered the father of South African zoology. Remember I said for Levaillant, considered the father of ornithology in South Africa, but Andrew Smith had a very broad interest in reptiles, fish, birds, insects, and so on. He is both found six new weaver species and described all of them. So in most cases, people found new birds and sent them off to Europe for someone else to figure out if it's a new species or not. Because you have to check, you know, has someone else described this bird or not? Does it look like something that's been collected? Whereas Andrew Smith had lots of books available and went through all of them and carefully described all the new birds that he found himself. He came to South Africa in 1820. He came to the Eastern Cape, Grahamstown, along with loads of other, all the 1820 settlers, and that's just because a bit of South African history, to try and settle the area against the Khoza, who were being pushed south by the Zulus, Shaka, up country in KwaZulu-Natal. So, at first, he was sent to South Africa to look after the soldiers and the army based on the border of the Eastern Cape. But 2 years later, he was appointed as district surgeon. And this was really great for Andrew Smith because he got to travel. He went to all the different outposts and places where people had farms to look after the sick. And at the same time, he was able to start collecting birds and animals. He, you know, through all this travel, it just piqued his interest, and he started collecting. He had a very scientific mind, and he started publishing, and the only place that was available to him in South Africa was the South African Commercial Advertiser, the earliest newspaper started in South Africa. And it started in 1824, and it stopped in 1879, although by that stage it had been taken over and the name had changed slightly a few times. But nevertheless, his very first description was of two weaver birds and in 1828. And he wrote about two species, the second one, the spectacled weaver, very common in the Eastern Cape, and it was a new species that had not been described before. So he gave a long description. Don't worry if you can't make this out. Unfortunately, the newspaper is a bit crinkled, but described the male and the female, so in great detail, and then just pointing out the female had a yellow throat, whereas the male's got the black throat. And then he said, found in similar situations to the foregoing species. And so if we just scroll up a bit, we see the first species that he wrote about is now considered the southern masked weaver, which had already been described about 10 years earlier by Velot, who had the specimen that Levaillant had collected. So Andrew Smith thought initially that this was a new species, and he gave it the name Personatus, but later people found out that actually it was exactly the same as the southern masked weaver, Velatus, and so it doesn't count as a new species. But nevertheless, here we can see he said, again, a long, good description, but then found in the eastern districts of the colony, so referring to the Eastern Cape where he was working. So that's where the spectacled and southern masked weavers both occur very commonly. And it's a trait that Andrew Smith was very interested in, and this is all his writings from this very early stage. He tried to describe the range of a species and did not say usually exactly where he found the species. You know, for instance, garden in Grahamstown or on a river running through or whatever. And it's only much later that the concept of type locality became very important. We need to know when a species was first described where it came from as best as possible because of subspecies varying and all sorts of other reasons. So But of course, it still is fine to know that because there's no variation in the Eastern Cape, so it doesn't matter too much, but it is really nice to be able to pinpoint where a bird was first collected. But for most of Andrew Smith's birds, all species and other snakes and insects and so on, we often don't know the exact locality. But I'll come to a bit more about that later. But nevertheless, he was very good with species descriptions, and later on in books he published later, also biology of the birds that he saw. Right, so this southern mast weaver, and here's the start of the spectacled weaver, which we saw in the previous slide, were the first two species. And then in the same year, just a month later, he already published some more birds and reptiles in the South African Commercial Advertiser. In 1825, however, he had been called to, that was 1828, but in the meantime, there was a gap where he was called to Cape Town, and he was appointed as the first director of the South African Museum. This put him in a really good position because he was able to bring his specimens to the museum that he had collected, and he was also able to see specimens that other people were collecting and depositing there. Of course, a lot of these early specimens ended up in England and didn't stay there, and it was only years later that the South African Museum tried really hard to keep locally collected specimens in the museum. Andrew Smith did a trip to the little Namaqua land, but just before going is when he actually wrote up the species accounts that he had collected in the Eastern Cape. He collected new species in Namaqua land, but not any new weaver birds. Then in 1830, he was sent by the army back to Grahamstown, and he was asked to visit Dingaan in KwaZulu-Natal, but he was in Grahamstown for quite a few months first in preparing for the trip. And while he was traveling around and still being a surgeon in the area, he traveled to the Great Kei River, where he collected the fan-tailed widow. And that is the species that the summer school has kindly put, they chose to do this, the species that they've put on the logo for this year's summer school. So when Andrew Smith first visited the Kei River, he found this new widow bird, and I don't know, I guess he just didn't have time to describe it properly. He just said, "Huh, it's a Vidya species," and he didn't provide a specific name. Probably just because he was preparing for his trip to visit Dingaan, which was a very successful trip, incidentally, and his report back to the British Army resulted in the British colonizing KwaZulu-Natal, or at the time Port Natal. So, but only in much later years, he revisited this and gave a name in 1838 to the fan-tailed widow, and called it axillaris here, referring to the red shoulder armpits. Right, and then because of his success in his trip talking to Dingaan, he was asked to also talk to the local tribes on the border of Botswana up here, and so he planned an even longer expedition into the interior of the country. It's not unknown. There were settlers here, and the interesting thing to note is the timing here, 1834 to 1836. If you're very good with your South African history, I'm not, but I read all this up. It's the time when the 1834 is the time when the first fur trackers left the Cape, and it took them about this. It was over several years that more and more of them left, and they made a beeline up country to get away from the political situation in the Cape. And of course, there were already settlers living this far. In fact, Robert Moffat had a mission station around here where Andrew Smith stopped as well. So there were not many. It was very poorly populated by whites, but there were people living in these different parts. But it's only with the fur trackers that South Africa became more populated by Europeans or white people. So it wasn't unknown territory, But there had been no decent zoological collections. So the people that had been going up here were missionaries and farmers and traders to some extent, but there had been just about no collecting of birds and other animals. So it was really an exciting opportunity for Andrew Smith, and he went off into Basutu land first and then cut across this way, went up all the way to around here, and then returned and just took a shortcut back here. So he had a whole team of people that went along with him on the expedition, and the most famous probably is Charles Bell, and he's known for first designing the coat of arms for the South African College, which is now University of Cape Town, and he also designed the emblem for Old Mutual, and also designed this well-known Cape Triangular stamp. So these are considered to be the oldest, some of the oldest corporate emblems in South Africa, and they're still in existence today. So Bell was chosen as an artist to come along with Andrew Smith. He painted landscapes and other general, and also paintings of the indigenous people. Here are Bushmen hunting game. They dressed up, camouflaged as ostrich. He did not paint any of the birds or animals at all. That wasn't his skill or interest. And so Andrew Smith, in later years, got someone else, an artist Ford, to illustrate all his birds and animals. Right, so the weavers that Andrew Smith collected on this trip were the white-browed sparrow weaver, the scaly-feathered finch, and the red-billed buffalo weaver, and that's approximately where he found them. I wrote a paper quite a few years ago where I went through his diary to specify these locations, and I'll explain a bit about that. So he again just gave very general distributions for these species. Now just a little bit of background snippets. It's been estimated that ox wagons in South Africa travel, oxen will travel in the morning, they need a rest in the afternoon, lunchtime, and then sometimes travelers would still travel a bit further in the late afternoon. Travel about 3 kilometers per hour. This is, of course, so about 15 kilometers per day. This is incredibly rough estimates. It depends on the terrain. It depends on how much the person leading the expedition wants to stop and look at or hunt along the way and things like that. So for working out the red-billed buffalo weaver locality, I took localities that Smith named. And so it was two well-known points that he mentioned, and it's a distance of 55 kilometers. So just in that stretch in the Northwest Province, he did about 5 kilometers per day over that 10-day period. But that is, of course, just the average. He would have probably traveled 10 to 15 kilometers and on some days just rested and not traveled at all. So often these early travelers would travel 15, 20, or 5 kilometers, depending on the terrain, stop for a day or two to hunt for fresh food and do some collecting and skinning and so on, and then again travel the next day. All right, so when Andrew Smith came back from his trip, he immediately published a report on all the new species. So he was very productive. There were no illustrations in this report at all, but he described a long list of new species, including these three weaver birds, which are a bit hard to see maybe, but here's Bubalornis, the buffalo weaver, and Loxia lathami is the red-billed quailia, but it had been described already by Linnaeus, so it doesn't count as a new species, just a new subspecies, and so on. Right, but now, the amazing thing is that he also kept a detailed diary of his trip. And it's only 100 years later that a professor, Kirby, became very interested in Andrew Smith. He was more interested in the musical instruments of the local tribes in South Africa and things like that. But he needed this diary to be available to be able to use the research in it. So in 1939, he published the first volume, and in 1940, the second volume. Now, just to show you, this is what Andrew Smith's diary looks like. I can't read that. I don't know if you can, but so it's quite a task. I mean, now that I can compare it, so here's 29 March, Sunday. When you compare it to the actual printed text, it's not so bad, because then you can see, divine service as usual. But if it wasn't for this, I would not be able to read this. I don't know about you. But so this is now very wide. I mean, so the original diary is in the South African Museum, but it would be very difficult to do anything with that. But now that it's been published, it's available easily. You can take it out from the library and read it. And so I read this and went through the details of where the different specimens were found, at least for the weavers, and I still hope to do this for all the other species that Andrew Smith described. The scaly-feathered finch is a bit confusing because he actually mentions that he had collected it somewhere down here near Graaf-Reinet as well, or that he had seen it there, as well as over here. And here he gives a lot more detail. He found a nest and describes that. And so it's generally considered that this is the correct type locality, and but we'll never know for sure. Right, then the white-browed sparrow weaver, again, just now here to illustrate. He wrote about it in his diary. Of course, he hadn't had time to think about what is it. And so he just wrote, the passer or sparrow with a white stripe over the eyes shot on the Mudder River. And again here, this passer got on the Vaal River, whistles very well. And over the next few pages, he keeps referring back to it. As he thinks of more things about it, he describes the nest and so on. But by looking at the date in his diary and where he traveled, one can plot a map. Well, this was done by Kirby, and see where he was, and so I was able to determine quite accurate type localities for the different weaver species. The red-billed buffalo weaver, there's something an interesting story there. When he saw it, he writes that he saw it associating with buffalo. Now one could think, now that's strange, because today we know that red-billed buffalo weavers do not associate with buffalo or other game. And sure, they may be in the tree above and there's game in the shade of the tree, but they don't really associate with them. He doesn't say more than just that they were associating with the birds, with the buffalo. And of course, it's possible that he was a good observer, even though he didn't have binoculars. And he probably got quite close to the birds. I mean, he certainly shot this specimen, which is in the Scottish Museum today. But so there's no doubt that he did see them with the buffalo. Maybe they were landed on them, it's not impossible, or just fed on insects or something that were disturbed by the buffalo. But so he called it the buffalo bird, Bubalornis, the genus. Just from the Greek bubalus, which is buffalo, and ornis, which means bird. And so that name has stuck because there's no reason to change it by the rules of naming in zoology, even though it's not the most accurate name. So what I would prefer is, so just to show you, today buffalo weavers nest on all sorts of man-made objects like this, but of course in the days of Andrew Smith there were no pylons or windmills or anything like that, so they could only breed on trees, which is what they still do today, of course. So here we see, and a variety of trees species are used, but always large trees because they have this very bulky nest made of thorny twigs, so you really need a strong tree to hold a nest. They're colonial. They like having lots of nests in the tree. But the one thing throughout Africa that's very conspicuous is that they like baobab trees. They don't only use baobab trees, but it's pretty often that you see their nests in baobab trees. And that applies for the white-billed as well as the red-billed buffalo weaver. So I would think a much better name for these would have been baobab weavers instead of buffalo weavers, would have been a bit more appropriate. But anyway, we stuck with the name as it is. Right, then, after his trip, Andrew Smith was recalled to England. Things were changing in South Africa and getting more settled for the time being, and so he wasn't needed as a military doctor anymore. And that's when he had time to start publishing all his collections. And it took him over a decade to do it. What he did was he did it plate by plate with a really extensive species description. And he had subscribers that could, for 10 shillings at the time, purchase each one of these plates. And he covered mammals, birds, fish, reptiles, and invertebrates. So he was very versatile in a large area of zoology in this production. In these illustrations, he included all the weavers he had already described, many that were not that he had not described, but all the birds he had collected. So he wrote, he had a section on the southern masked weaver, although by that stage he realized that it had been given that name by Villot already previously. So it was about birds. It wasn't only new birds, but he certainly did have two new species. As I mentioned, the fan-tailed widow, he now gave a species name for the first time, so he's credited with that, even though he had mentioned it years earlier. Also, he had described the yellow weaver as a new species. Interestingly enough, while he had been at the South African Museum, he obtained specimens of the yellow weaver from East Africa, as well as his own specimens from the Eastern Cape. And they're two different subspecies, and he thought they were two different species, so he gave two different names in the illustrations that he published, but later they were merged into one species. But he had described this one first, the Southern African one, and so that name, Sub aureus, that he gave is the name for the species today. The interesting thing is that there's another species in Tanzania, the Ruvu species weaver, which has not been formally accepted as species yet, but I'll talk about that, quite an interesting story, on Friday. Right, it's quite a puzzle why Andrew Smith did not come across the thick-billed weaver, which was common in Algoa Bay, and we don't know who collected it, but someone collected it, sent it to England on some passing ship, and Henry Ellis was the person who had it in his possession and gave it to a zoologist, Viggers, who did the first species description. But if Andrew Smith just never found it or shot a specimen or whatever, we don't know, but he missed out on this species. Then just very briefly, Andrew Smith was called to be the surgeon in the Crimean War. And that, of course, is where Florence Nightingale became a household name in caring for the soldiers. It was terribly difficult circumstances, and Andrew Smith at the time was criticized for doing a really bad job. But in later years, people have realized that it wasn't due to Andrew Smith that there were such terrible conditions. He kept petitioning the British government to send more medicines, to send more staff, and it just fell on deaf ears. So he was actually stuck with insufficient supplies and staff. But certainly Florence Nightingale is the person who was caring so much and realized the importance of hygiene, something that had not been appreciated before that time. And when she came back to England, campaigned for better hygiene conditions in field hospitals and general hospitals. Right. Andrew Smith is commemorated in mainly reptiles, three reptile species. People have chosen to use Smith in the surname, specifically referring to Andrew Smith. Of course, there are a lot of other Smiths that have been zoologists and are commemorated in different species, but these specifically refer to him. And also, Andrew Smith collected, of course, many birds, described many birds, and the one bird that he described was the broadbill. When he visited KwaZulu-Natal, he collected a broadbill somewhere probably near Dingaan's Kraal. But he gave it this genus, which was later found not to be a suitable genus. And as the taxonomy changed, Bonaparte, a French ornithologist, descendant of the famous Bonaparte, he came up with a new genus name for the African broadbill species, based, and he did it in commemoration of Andrew Smith. All right. So that's Andrew Smith and his part in South African zoology, and probably even more famous in the reptile world than bird world, but he played an incredibly important part in all of the zoological aspects in South Africa. Right, but there are lots of other people in this early 1800s all over Africa collecting birds and animals, and I'm just going to list one or two. So here's Sir Edward Sabine. He was an astronomer and geophysicist. He traveled around the world to study how round the Earth really was, something that wasn't known for sure in those days. And he again also collected different birds and animals on his different travels to America as well as Africa. And so as you can see up there, he collected two weaver bird species, but also he's commemorated in the name Sabine's Gull, a species that we get off in winter off the coast of Cape Town as well. The two species he collected were from West Africa, the blue-billed Malimbi and the yellow-mantled weaver. He sent them off to Europe, and they were described by various people there. Right. Oh, yes, and then yesterday I mentioned John Casson. So he was the curator of the Philadelphia Museum, and that is considered to be the oldest natural history museum in the world. It was established with funding in Philadelphia, and quite a few correspondents sent specimens directly to him, as well as I mentioned, he had bought collections in Europe. He had a person, I can't remember his name, who actually went to London and looked for specimens all the time. When he found bargains, new species, he'd buy them and send them off to John Casson. So through that, even though John never visited Africa, he did describe five new weaver bird species, and these are the five species: white-winged widow, cinnamon weaver from East Africa, Zanzibar red bishop, Rachel's Malimbi, red-vented Malimbi. Rachel's Malimbi, he named after his daughter. So in zoology, it's not considered kosher to name a bird or animal after yourself, but you can always get around it by calling it after a family member. That's quite okay, you're allowed to do that. Right, so here we see that in the early 1800s, there was a dramatic increase in the number of birds that had been collected, so of all bird species as well as weavers. Even though there's this bit of a peak here, I mean, this is just a large rise with new birds being found all over the world. And that's the last slide for today's talk. Any questions? Still trying, yes.
You showed pictures of the
yes. Right. Something I haven't mentioned yet is the whole species concept. It is something that is still not settled completely in zoology. So people have different ideas, and one is the biological species concept, where if two birds interbreed, normally then it's the same species. But of course, many species never come into contact with each other, and in fact, speciation, so one has to understand a bit about how speciation and biogeography works. So a species may occur across Africa over millennia, and then you have climate change. So in fact, I'll give a good example, chestnut weaver. It occurs in Namibia and it occurs in East Africa. It doesn't occur in between. And there are many other species, some of the bustards and larks, where you have the same pattern. And we know from environmental studies going back in the past that at one stage there was an arid band right across from East Africa to southwestern Africa. And so that's why a bird like the chestnut weaver would have occurred everywhere. But then Angola, Zambia, those parts became wetter, savanna, and so the chestnut weaver disappeared from there, but it's still found in these two areas. Now, in time, that in East Africa, it could evolve into a different species, so different that if it joined back up again, if the drought or the dry area came back, they would not interbreed because it's so different now, just through adaptations of the song, the beak, or nesting biology or whatever. So, but now that they're separate, we still look at them, we say, well, they're so similar, we'll still say it's one species, but it's two different subspecies. But then you get an incredibly strange example. It's bizarre. In biology, there are a lot of principles and rules, but they are not laws as in physics. In physics, you've got the law of gravity and it works. But there's a species in Eurasia, the ring-billed gull, and in Western Europe, it looks one way and it gradually changes as you grow across to Eastern Europe, to Russia, and then America, Canada. But by the time you get right to the end of Eastern Canada, it looks completely different. And if you looked at the two gulls, you would say they're two different species. But it's a gradual transition all the way around the world. So it's a very perplexing situation, you know, is it one species or two? And so there are a lot of cases where it's very easy. This bird is one species, no doubts, no problems whatsoever. But then there are lots of cases where it's confusing and the definition of biological species concept doesn't work. And so people have come up with other definitions, but there's no definition that works for all biological cases. So it's something that people still grapple with and work on. Now coming to the thick-billed weaver. So when these different forms were first described, mostly they were described as new species. And later on people said, well, yes, there's differences in the plumage, but actually it's the same species. And so they would be merged by people working on the different birds. And in some cases they get split again. So a good example is the black kite, yellow-billed kite. It has been merged and split so many times you just lose count over the last 50 years even. You know, and some people say, no, it's one species. Others say, no, it's two species. So it's very confusing sometimes. The interesting thing is that, and something I've been working on, is that altogether, if you look at every single name that has been given, scientific name that's been given to weavers, there are over 600. But most of those are subspecies or invalid names. And so it's only 117 species that are actually recognized as valid species today, but 600 were described at some point in time. I'm only focusing on those that are considered actual species at the moment. But so it's the same for all the other birds and, in fact, reptiles and fish and everything else. A lot more have been described, but they've been what's called synonymized. In other words, you say, oh, this name is actually a synonym. It actually belongs in this species group. Okay, and Sue?
Yes, yesterday you spoke about the skeletons.
Yes. Oh, the structure varies, so it's just easier to see. I mean, you can look at a thick-billed weaver and a red-billed buffalo weaver, and the plumage is different, so it's fine. But even so, the skeleton will be different. The forearm will be longer in the buffalo weaver because it's bigger. You can measure the wing, but by looking at the skeleton, there are many more little details that you can see that are different. And I'm just trying to think of examples, and I just can't think of any specific examples right now. But each species is different, and a skeleton is something where you can measure it very nicely. I mean, even measuring a wing length, you'll know from ringing, there's a bit of flexibility because there's flesh around the wing, whereas measuring the bones, you can measure it very accurately. But also, the more related birds are, the more similar the skeleton is. So a sparrow, there'll be some bones that are a little bit different to a weaver's bones. Again, it's not something I've studied, so I've got papers that I've got available on my laptop, but I haven't studied the differences myself. It's not something I've been that interested in to go, that I can remember it. I can look it up and maybe find a picture of an example where you see a clear difference in one of the bones in one species. And so, the amazing thing about bones as well is, and this is, for instance, the dodo talk yesterday, is bones don't decay very easily. And so one can look at fossil deposits and still build up a skeleton from millennia ago, or even just from recently. Very important in forensics as well. And so one can look at, you know, bones and say, I think to some extent you can sometimes tell in human forensics, you know, if there's a crime scene and you've got just the skeleton of a person who was murdered, for instance, you can tell things about it, you know, what age, and there's different things you can see. So bones tell you a lot about, one thing is about species, but also age or gender sometimes, it varies. But bones tell lots of things. It's just not my field of expertise.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yeah, sure. So that's why you have to look at lots of factors. You can never take one thing and say, oh, this bone is different to this one. That makes a different species. You can't do that. It's hard work. You have to look at all the different aspects. But the skeleton is a very useful criteria. And it's not just that it's the bone length or something. Sometimes there's there might be an additional small bone or a completely different shaped bone in one group of birds compared to a different one. So it may not always be that useful for species. I think it's probably more useful for groups. You can tell, now it's obvious. Here's an obvious example. It's a bit too obvious, but an ostrich and flightless birds have got very short wing bones, and whatever they're called, compared to birds that fly. And so just by looking at the skeleton, you can say, in proportion to the rest of the skeleton, this bird can't fly, even if you don't know what it is, because it's such a short wing bone compared to the size of the skeleton. So that's actually a good example of just a very critical difference, and that's to do with the behavior or adaptation of the bird. But there are other things as well. So for instance, the skulls of woodpeckers will be different to the skulls of barbets, and that's because they've got this massively long tongue that's curled up in the back of the skull, so there has to be a cavity to make space for it. So skulls, I know, are very good indicators of differences because of the adaptation of the beak. You know, a bird that hammers as well, it's got to have a stronger skull, so it will be a thicker bone. So it's that kind of thing, differences where the thickness, the shape, and all these kinds of things. Hope that helps. Okay, yes.
Can you explain the reason for that spike in the curve that you've got occurred in 1890? The number of species?
Over there, for the weavers. I have thought about it. I haven't gone into my data to study it in that much detail, but I suspect it's the rare weavers. And some groups of birds, all birds have got common species and rare species, but I think it's just a very large number of rare species in the deep Congo. So it's yellow-legged weaver, one of the rarest or most poorly known weavers, the golden-naped weaver, and it's just a whole lot of those, and I'll be talking about this a bit in the next few days. When Stanley and other people started going into the Congo, they found these birds, and it's in that time period. So it's just as Africa was explored more and more. And yes, it is a bit strange, and I need to look at it in a bit more detail, but I think it's just that they're just a bigger proportion of rare weavers hidden away in Central Africa compared to other birds. Yes, Barry. It's not quite like that. There's, I'll definitely be talking about this. There's a commission that decides on the naming of birds. There are lots of rules, and I'll talk about that. But that's not about saying if a species is a valid species or not. So in the old days that I've been talking about, you just find a bird and you say, oh, this is a new species. You give it a name. And then later on, someone else comes along, a museum worker usually, and says, no, wait a minute. This looks the same as one that's been described by someone else. So actually, it's a synonym. It belongs under there. It's not a new species. But then someone else could disagree and say, but no, it is a new species. You're wrong. So it's a peer review process where you can study the birds and look at them and say, I think it's a new species. You write it up, give your reasons, but someone else can dispute that. And that's what is happening in zoology all the time. Nowadays, it's a lot more difficult to describe a new species and get away with it than it was in those days. There it was easy. You just write it up and it's published. Of course, someone will dispute it if it's not a new species. Nowadays, if you don't have a really good argument, it's not even going to get published. So you have to be very careful. There's a way of, there's rules about how to do it nowadays. But still, new species are being described. It's largely, and I'll be talking more about this later, but just briefly, it's amazingly, new owls are being found in the Philippines or you know, that whole area in the east. But you know, it also depends on your species definition. Each island's got a different Scops owl, and they look different, have a slightly different call, so people are describing them as new species. So those are cryptic species. Then, of course, there's the splits, genetic studies, where it says, oh, but actually, we thought it was one species, but the genes tell us that there really are two. Yes. Yes, absolutely. Friday. Yeah. I'll be talking about it's the Kilimberro weaver from Tanzania, but I'll be talking about that. And there's a small possibility for there to still be some new species in the Central African marshes. There's just not enough samples from there. There's the Lake Lufira weaver, described in the 1900s, so more recently, but there's possibility of more species, but maybe not. It's hard to tell. Yes. No, Barry, yeah. For South Africa, yes. Yes, definitely. And as I said, not just birds, also all the other fields. So a very versatile man. Very skilled.
Just comment to you, yes. You pointed out the speed of this oxbow.
Oh, yeah, please do.
My first job was working in a large cattle ranch in Matabeleland in the early 50s, and we used oxen and oxbows.
Right. Oh, thank you. I mean, the number 15 is from not my own. I calculated Andrew Smith's, but I mean, I also gave numbers that I got from other sources. So, but that's great to hear. Thanks. Yeah.
We used to take cattle from the ranch up to the railhead.
Right.
And send them to Bulawayo to the Health Storage Commission. And so we'd have an ox wagon with stuff on. We'd spend a day and a half.
Wow. Yes. Yeah. No, thanks. That's fascinating. I can't say I've ever been on an ox wagon except the ones at Blood River, but those are just the bronze casts that have been replicated. Yeah. Okay. Any more final questions? Okay. So, see you tomorrow. Right. Pleasure. Okay.